In the previous lectures, we have learnt about vectors. We have seen how two vectors can be added, how one vector can be subtracted from another vector, and how two vectors can be multiplied. I hope you have understood all this, because now we are in a position to use the vector algebra in mechanics. And the first thing that we do is displacement vector, velocity vector, and acceleration. Suppose you are at the point A, whose position is given by this vector A from the origin to the point where we are located. This is vector A. So, our position vector is A. After some time, suppose we reach the position vector B, then the difference between B and A is known as the displacement vector. We were at A. After some time, we reach at B, where both A vector and B vector are our positions with respect to a certain coordinate system. Then the difference between B and A, between the final position and the initial position, is the displacement vector B minus A. So, the displacement vector denoted by capital S is equal to vector B minus vector A. It is called displacement vector or simply displacement, but you must remember that it is a vector. Notice that we have not said anything about the path that might be taken between the position A and position B. In fact, if you started at point A, took all kinds of curves and paths and came back to point A, your displacement would be 0, because the difference between the final vector and initial vector is 0. So, your displacement would be 0. So, the path does not matter. What matters is the final position and the initial position, and the difference between these two positions is the displacement vector. That is what matters, not what path we take. In fact, if you go around a circle many times, as a runner does in a race many times, you come back after one circular path, you come back to the same point. So, your displacement is 0. But in one circle, you have covered a distance equal to 2 pi r. If you went n times round this circle and came back to the same point, your displacement will be 0, but the distance covered by you would be 2 pi r times n, the number of rotations that you take. Let us take another example. Suppose you started from vector A, whose position is 2 I cap minus 3 j cap plus 5 k cap. I hope you remember these friends, I cap, j cap, k cap. These are unit vectors along the x direction, along the y direction, and along the z direction. They are our friends, and do not forget them, you remember them always. And vector B is given by 3 I cap plus 5 j cap minus 4 k cap. What is your displacement? Your displacement would be the final position, that is B, minus the initial position, that is A, and therefore, delta S vector would be equal to this difference, and the result is, it is 1 times I cap plus 8 times j cap minus 9 times k cap. And if from position A to position B, I have taken time delta t, small time delta t, then the rate of change would be delta s by delta t, and this is equal to the velocity. So, the velocity would be equal to displacement vector divided by delta s vector divided by delta t. And since delta s is a vector, v is also a vector. So, we come to the result that vector v is equal to delta s vector divided by delta t. Both sides you can check are vectors, as I have been emphasizing. If the equation is a vector equation, both sides must be vectors. So, let me write down again, vector v is equal to delta s vector divided by delta t. And here I have drawn a graph for you. Displacement vector on one side and time on the other side. And if you remember your class 9 and 10 mathematics, you would remember that slope of this graph is the rate of change. And in this case, the rate of change is of what? Of displacement with time. And how do you find that? You drop a perpendicular on the time axis and then draw a line along the x axis, and this is delta s, this is delta t. And if you take the ratio delta s by delta t, the ratio delta s by delta t, that is the slope of this graph. And delta s by delta t is our velocity. So, velocity is the rate of change of the displacement time graph. So, if we have a graph in which we have on the y axis displacement, on the x axis we have time, then the velocity is given by the slope of this graph. We could have taken smaller delta s and delta t, and we shall see this process, how this process leads us to the definition of instantaneous velocity. Now, for your exercise, there are two friends, Nas and Simi, and these are their displacement graphs. This is for Nas, this is for Simi. Can you tell who among them is faster? Easy. Find out the slope, that is the rate of change. So, the slope of this graph of Nas is larger than the slope of this graph of Simi. So, therefore, Nas has higher velocity, because the rate of change along this graph is higher than the rate of change along this graph. So, simply looking at the graphs, you can find out which one has larger velocity. In the last slide, we used straight lines, but the displacement time graph is not always a straight line. It can be a curved line. This is not displacement time, but this is xy graph, and this is a curved graph, simply to inform you that the slope is changing now. How do you find the slope? At the point Q, for example, draw tangent to the curve and then draw delta y and delta x, and delta y by delta x gives the slope at the point Q. At the point P, the slope is given by this delta y by this delta x, and you can see that the slope at P is smaller than the slope at Q. And if I took a point here, the slope at Q would be smaller than the slope at this point. That means the slope in this graph is increasing, slope is changing, that is important. Here again I show you another graph, but this time the slope is negative, but its magnitude is decreasing as the time increases. Here the slope is larger, here the slope is smaller. So, as the time progresses, the magnitude of the slope decreases. Let us use this in another graph. Here I have got a displacement time graph in which the displacement is decreasing with time along this curve. And what do we find? We find that the slope at this point is larger than the slope at this point. It would be larger than the slope at this point. That means, as time increases, the magnitude of the slope is decreasing. That is, the velocity of the object is decreasing as time increases. Let us take another graph this time. Displacement time graph again, but in this case the displacement is increasing. And you can, as I have shown you in the earlier slide, the slope is now increasing. Let me remind you, the slope increasing as we move along this axis. Here, the slope is increasing as we move along the time axis. That means, as the time increases, the slope increases, therefore, the rate of change also increases. That means, the velocity increases with time. Now, so far we have dealt with finite quantities, delta s, although small but finite, and delta t, small but finite. And let us take the point P on this curve. If we want to find out the rate of change at P, I draw a tangent to the curve at the point P, then I take delta s by delta t. I can take smaller triangle, delta s by delta t. If I want to find out at the point P, I will have to take a very small triangle, very small delta s and very small delta t. In the limit, this is called ds by dt. So, instantaneous velocity at the point P not at any other point, at the point P itself, the instantaneous velocity is given by ds by dt, that is the slope at the point P itself. This is a limiting sort of exercise, and we get from V equal to delta S by delta t this important result that vector V is equal to derivative of the displacement S. So, if I want to find out the instantaneous velocity at any point, I simply take the derivative of S at that point. V at that point would be the derivative ds by dt. About derivatives, if occasion arises, I will tell you in later lectures. Usually, we are interested in instantaneous velocity, as I have been saying, and then we get V equal to ds by dt. And as I have been saying earlier also, velocity is a vector, because both sides are vectors. So, on this side this S vector, on this side this velocity, it must be a vector. And therefore, it would be wrong to say that velocity of a bus is 5.0 meters per second. The correct way would be to say that the velocity of the bus is 5.0 meters per second in the north direction. Remember, vector needs both magnitude and direction for its description. In ordinary life, we don't use velocity very much. In ordinary life, we are used to term speed. And what is speed? In the earlier graph, I showed you that the path for the displacement path does not matter. But if we measured the length along the path and denoted by small s, then the speed would be the total distance travelled divided by the total time taken, that is s by t. And s by t is the average speed, because we have not taken smaller amounts. We have taken the total distance travelled and divided by the total time taken. If we took small distance and small time, then we will get instant speed ds by dt, where the small s denotes the distance travelled. And you can see ds is not a vector, it is a scalar, it is the distance travelled, length covered, and therefore speed is a scalar. Velocity is a vector, speed is a scalar. What is the relation between these two? It is very important, because many times students are confused. Suppose we are moving along this curve, an object is moving along this curve. We take two points very close together. Of course, I will show them a little apart. I can't take them very close, because you won't be able to see. But imagine these points A and B are very close together, very near each other. Then the displacement between A and B would be equal to the distance between A and B. The displacement between A and B would be equal to the length AB, or the distance between A and B. That means what? That means that at a given point, the instantaneous speed is equal to the magnitude of the instantaneous velocity at that time. Why is it so? Because the displacement is equal to the distance covered. Therefore, the instantaneous velocity, the magnitude of the instantaneous velocity is equal to the speed at that point. This is a very important relation, and you must remember that the instantaneous speed of an object is just the magnitude of its instantaneous velocity. So, you find instantaneous velocity and forget about the direction, the magnitude gives us the speed. Let me repeat this graph again between displacement and time, where the rate of change is increasing upwards, that means the velocity is increasing with time. When velocity increases with time, it means it is not uniform. If the velocity is not uniform, it means that the motion is accelerated. It is obvious that some force must be acting, because if there is no force acting, then the velocity cannot change. So, if the velocity is changing, the motion is accelerated, and obviously some force must be acting on it.